Becoming obsessed with what God thinks about you is the quickest way to forget what people think about you. Living for an audience of one, saying, God, I want to please you with all that I do. That is the quickest, the best, and perhaps the only way to grow past living for the approval of others. Becoming obsessed with what God thinks about you. Do you care about what other people think about you? Well, this week on Connecting the Gap, we're going to talk about that, and we'll be back right after this. Of hope, the weary world rejoices till yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Are you ready to join the army of warriors who conquer all challenges life throws their way? Look no further than We Are Warriors Apparel at wearewarriorsapparel.com. Their merchandise is designed to empower and inspire individuals to overcome any obstacle standing in their path. From stylish, comfortable clothing to eye-catching accessories, their merchandise is crafted with utmost care and attention to detail. But what truly sets them apart is their powerful slogan, Overcome. It represents the indomitable spirit within every warrior, urging you to push boundaries, shatter limitations, and transform your dreams into reality. It encapsulates overcoming self-doubt, adversity, and fears to emerge stronger and more resilient. With every purchase of We Are Warriors apparel, you not only receive exceptional merchandise, but also a reminder to embrace your untapped courage and strength. From their Overcome t-shirts that serve as a daily source of motivation, to their Overcome hoodies and joggers that symbolize your triumphs, their offerings are designed to keep your spirit high and unstoppable. Unlock the potential within you and express it proudly through their high quality apparel. Step out into the world with an aura of fearlessness, knowing that you are part of the warrior clan that never surrenders. Don't settle for mediocrity. Embrace your inner warrior and let We Are Warriors Apparel be your partner in conquering life's battles. Visit wearewarriorsapparel.com today and equip yourself with the emblem of resilience, determination, and the will to overcome. Together, we are unstoppable. Welcome to Connecting the Gap, and things are a little bit different around here this week. You probably already noticed some Christmas music going on here in the background, and we've got a special episode coming your way. We're taking a break from our normal series that we've been doing here recently, Who is Jesus? Of course, last week we talked about Jesus is Love, which was really an excellent episode to lead us up into this week. As we're going to take a break here, next week we'll get back into that. We have a couple more episodes coming your way of that series before we switch gears and kick off into another study at that point after the first of the year. But as I've been telling you here for a few weeks now, we have a special episode coming your way, and I hope that you will enjoy it. Hopefully you guys have a good week lined up here ahead of you, maybe the rest of this year. Probably have some days off of work, possibly some time with family. And of course, just remembering that price that Christ paid on Calvary. He came as a baby born in a manger to save the world from our sins. And I'm so thankful that he did that. That's what we celebrate here in this Christmas season. You can visit my website at connectingthegap.net for everything about our ministry. You can listen to this podcast by subscribing wherever you get your podcast. We're also on YouTube Rumble. And if you have smart devices such as Alexa or Google devices, you can catch us on those as well. And of course, we don't charge for this podcast. It is free. I do this each week as a ministry, and I hope that you guys enjoy it. One way that you could support us, though, if you are listening to us on Apple or YouTube, Rumble, maybe Spotify. There's areas there that you can give us reviews, and you can also rate the podcast on Apple. I'd love for you to give me a good rating on there and a good review that helps other people that don't know about the ministry to learn a little bit about what other people think about it and maybe get them to join as well. And maybe through all of that, we can reach some people that are lost, some people that need to know Jesus and what the reason is for this Christmas season. Well, without further ado, we're going to go ahead and get into this special episode this week on Connecting the Gap as we get into this week of our Christmas episode for 2023. This week, if you have your Bibles with you or your Bible app, and you want to turn to Matthew chapter 1, we're going to see the angel appear to Joseph and talk about how do we overcome our fear of what people think about us. You know, I want to start this out this week with a question. How many of you would say that you often care a lot about what other people think about you? You know, the reality is that at one level or another, all of us are very concerned. You know, do you like the car that I drive? Do you like the clothes that I wear? Do you like my hairstyle? Do you think that I'm funny? Do I fit in? Do you like my Instagram selfie? I mean, you know, if I hold it up here, I have two chins. If I hold it down here, I have four. Do you like this filter with my duck lips? Do you like my duck lips? And you know, we become so easily obsessed with what other people think about us. In this week's story, we're going to watch Joseph battle with the opinions of people when he has to decide between doing what is easy and what is right, between what people would want him to do, and between what God wants him to do. And so let me give you some context here, and then we're going to dive into this special Christmas episode on Connecting the Gap. Joseph is engaged to be married to a young teenage girl. She's a virgin girl named Mary. Now, in this time in history, engagements were a lot different than they are today. Today, if you're engaged and things kind of go weird, then you can just say, hey, see you later. I'm breaking off this engagement. Well, back in this time, an engagement was actually a binding agreement. You would be engaged for a year's period of time, and in that time, if you wanted to break it off, break off that engagement, you actually had to file for divorce. So the only way to get out of an engagement during this time would be to get divorced or to die. And the engagement was so serious that if one of the two people died, the one would be considered a widow or a widower. So this was what the engagement would mean. So with that in mind, that context here, we pick up the story in Matthew chapter 1, verses 18. And this is Matthew's version of how the birth of Christ came to be. He said, this is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Now you can just read this. But if you try to get to the minds of Joseph and Mary, you have to admit that this had to be a really odd conversation. When Mary sits down with her fiancé and says, oh, Joey, honey bunches, I've got something to tell you. I'm pregnant. But wait a minute. Don't jump to conclusions here. The good news is it's by the Holy Spirit. Well, now, if I'm Joseph, and I'm kind of like, and how long did it take you to come up with this story? Don't give me that Holy Spirit stuff. I saw the way that guy was checking you out at the well. Yeah, that just doesn't feel right to me. So you have to admit, from a human perspective, he's got two options. If you factor out the possibility that God actually did that, he's got two options. You know, this chick is crazy, or she's a liar. And I don't want to marry someone that's crazy or a liar. She says, I'm pregnant, and the Holy Ghost did it. So you have to acknowledge at some point that Joseph is going to be asking himself, okay, if I stay with this girl, what's everybody going to say? What are they going to think about us? Because from her perspective, she's already marked. This was a sin during this time to be pregnant out of wedlock. That was punishable by death. At that time, they would stone you for this. From his perspective, he's marked for the rest of his life. If he's the guy that got her pregnant, or she got pregnant with someone else, then from that point on, he's going to be finding it hard to find a job. If he divorces her, then at that point, no other father is going to want to bless his daughter to be married to him. He might find it difficult to get people to do business with him. You know, he's taking his donkey in for an oil change, and the people say, you know, we don't work on that kind of donkey here at this place, because everybody's going to know what was going on in this guy's life. So we don't know for sure the state of mind, but we do know from the text that he is bailing on this relationship. He's done. Either he doesn't believe her, or he doesn't want to take the heat, or whatever it may be, but he thinks about it and he's like, okay, it's best to move on down the road. Well, in verse 19, we see how this unfolds. It says, but because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. So here it is. He's jumping out on the relationship. Now, there's a lot of commentaries out there that say that divorcing her quietly was actually a very noble and honoring thing to do. And I probably tend to agree from his perspective. What he's thinking is, I'm not going to expose her to public shame. I'm not going to say to everybody, hey, she cheated on me, stone her to death. He actually probably really loves her and cares about her. And he thinks, you know, maybe she can go have this baby somewhere and maybe hopefully start over. You know, and then I'll start over and we'll just move on down the road. And he's about to learn one of the most important life lessons for those who want to honor God. Are you ready for it? Well, if you're taking notes, this is a big one. He's going to learn that pleasing God often means disappointing people. He's going to learn the powerful truth that if you want to obey God, there will be many times when other people will not agree and they will not understand. Pleasing God often means disappointing people. And here's how the story goes down, verses 20 and 21. It says, but after Joseph had considered this, in other words, he's thinking through, here's the pros, here's the cons. The cons of staying her, you know, they outweigh the pros. So I'm going to break up with her and move on down the road. In verse 20, after he considered all this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, fear not. The King James Version says, fear not. My version says, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. Verse 21 is so powerful. It says, she will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. You will give him the name Jesus, because he will save people from their sins. At this moment, when he awakes from the dream, you have to imagine the pendulum swing of emotions inside Joseph's mind. He's like, my gosh, for centuries and centuries, it's been prophesied that a Messiah would come. And here an angel of the Lord has told me that I get to be a part of the greatest event in history. And at the same time, the emotions have to swing the other way. Oh my gosh, what are people going to say about me? What's this going to cost me? On one hand, I get to possibly change the world. On the other hand, I have no idea how difficult this will be. Everyone else around me is going to say, run for your life. Don't marry this girl. She's sinned and should be put to death by stoning. On the other hand, should I please God? Should I do what people want? Or should I do what God wants? And I can promise you, if you're a follower of Jesus, at different points in your life, you're going to be confronted with opportunities to obey God or do something easier to win the approval of people. And he's going to learn these very important principles. If you're taking notes, why does this matter so much? The first thing, and this is gigantic in our lives, is this. Becoming obsessed with what people think about you is the quickest way to forget what God thinks about you. Becoming obsessed with what people think about you is the quickest way to forget what God thinks about you. And the reality is, for most of us, we drift toward wanting to please people. You know, what do you think of me? Do you like me? You know, do I fit in? Do I measure up? I mean, am I cool enough? Do you like what I'm doing? Can I be a part of your club? Can we be friends? Do you think I'm doing the right thing? And suddenly, without even meaning to, we surrender our lives to the opinions of people at the expense of actually living to please God. How do we overcome that? Becoming obsessed with what people think about you is the quickest way to forget what God thinks about you. Here's the good news, and this is so powerful. The flip side is true as well. Becoming obsessed with what God thinks about you is the quickest way to forget what people think about you. Living for an audience of one, saying, God, I want to please you with all that I do. That is the quickest, the best, and perhaps only way to grow past living for the approval of others. Becoming obsessed with what God thinks about you. And here's the bottom line. When you think about it, you can't please everyone. If you try to please people, you're going to fail at some point. If you wear your hair one way, hey, do you like this? Oh, yeah, I like it. You're cool now. And another group says, no, that's ugly and makes you look fat. And I like this kind of music. Do I fit in? Yes, you do. And no, you don't. If I believe this politically, do I? Yes, I do. No, I don't. How about I stand in the middle? Well, then we all hate you. Or whatever the case may be, there's lots of arguments that can be tossed around in that situation, because if you try to please one group, you displease someone else. And the bottom line is, no matter how hard you try, you cannot please everyone. But the good news is, you can please God. You can live a life where God looks at you and says, you did good. You did the right thing. You brought glory to my name. Well done, my good and faithful servant. But how do we overcome living for what everyone else thinks? We surrender ourselves to the living for an audience of one. Because becoming obsessed with what God thinks about us is the quickest way to become set free of what people think about us. And Joseph is going to have to get to a place in his life where he says, you know what? I value the opinion of God above the opinion of people. Now, how does this play out in our everyday lives? And I'm going to give you two big thoughts to take with you and apply and to put into play in your life. I'm going to put it under the subtitle, How Do We Live for God Instead of for People? We're going to have two thoughts on this, and we're going to do that when we come back. We're going to take a break for a moment here on this special Christmas episode on Connecting the Gap, and we're going to be back right after this. I miss the white Christmas, I miss the snow, I miss the icicle, I miss the tumble. Friends call me Snow Miser, whatever I touch turns to snow in my clutch. I'm too much. My brother and I work with young people that have hard lives. Sometimes we feel that hurt with them. One Christmas, we visited a theme park that was decorated beautifully. I remember Brad said, man, holiday decorations are always special, but wow, did I really need the lights this year. Maybe you've had that kind of year. Long, hard, chaotic, strained relationships, a dwindling bank account, maybe losing a loved one. Maybe for you, it's more the heartbreak season than the holiday season. Did you know that God's book says he has kept track of every tear you've cried? That he wants to wipe away each one and bring peace and purpose to your life? He doesn't want the pain of your past to define you anymore. God's book says he binds up the brokenhearted. That when you begin a relationship with him through Jesus' death and resurrection, you can be forgiven and free. You can find out more by calling 888-NEED-HIM or by going to chataboutjesus.com and find the true light this Christmas.
So this is Christmas, and what have you done? Another year over, a new one just begun. And so this is Christmas, and what have you done?
Welcome back to the special Christmas episode of Connecting the Gap. We've taken a break from our series we've been doing on Who is Jesus? And we're doing a special Christmas episode as Christmas is coming up here this next week. And then, of course, following that, we'll get back to our series we've been in. We'll finish that up here around the first of the year and get on to new things. Hope you guys are enjoying this week. We're going to go ahead and continue here. As we go into the break, we were talking about how it plays out in our life, about how do we live for God instead of for people. Because we get put in those positions sometimes where we have to make a choice. We have to decide, are we going to please God and do what He asks us to do? Or are we so worried about what people think about us that we're going to put God to the side and make them happy? And as I was saying, we have two thoughts that we can put into play here to help us live for God instead of for people. The first one, if you're taking notes, this will really speak to many of you, I think. It did to me. It's so important because when you're living for God, not everybody's going to like it. Pleasing God often means disappointing people. If you're not ready to be criticized for your obedience to God, you are not ready to be used by God. That's the number one thought. You can write that down. If you're not ready to be criticized for your obedience to God, you are not ready to be used to God. There's some power in that. You know, think about all the different ways that Joseph and Mary would be criticized. I mean, they would be publicly disgraced again and again and over and over. People would whisper about them, hey, you know, that's not really Joseph's baby. Or they might be saying, hey, you know, they say it was the Holy Ghost, but I saw his donkey parked outside of her apartment at 2 a.m. And you know, they were just doing Bible studies at 2 a.m., you know, or whatever the case may be. And I mean, this was like huge and a huge public disgrace. And I don't know how it will play out in your life, but there's going to be a time when you're reading God's Word and God's Word tells you to do something that is culturally unpopular. And if you obey, guess what? You're going to be criticized. Or you may hear the voice of God leading you to do something. You may be a teenager, a college student, or a full-blown adult, and you're trying to break free of the party lifestyle. You say, I'm going to serve Christ. I'm not getting drunk anymore, and I'm not doing drugs anymore. And all your party friends are going to be like, what are you doing, you religious freako? Or you might say, you know what? No matter what I did in the past, from now on, I'm going to honor God with sexual purity. And people are like, and you're what? I mean, that's like the stupidest. Do you know what year we live in and how much fun the bonga bonga is to do? And you're going to do this? That's crazy, you religious loser freako. And they're going to make fun of you. Or you may say, you know what? You guys are going to the beach for spring break, but I feel called to go and serve the poor on a mission trip. And they're going to be like, why are you going to spend your money to go do something that stupid? And they're going to continue to stand there and just make fun of you. Or you may be in a place where you actually leave a high-paying job to go to a lower-paying job because you feel like God was calling you to do something with your life that would actually contribute to society. And you feel like you could make a difference at this new job even though the pay isn't as high. And everybody's like, well, why would you do that? I mean, life's all about money, right? That's pretty stupid, you idiot. Or maybe you're going to live beneath your means and you may stay in a profitable job and you may live on less than you actually make so that you can give sacrificially and generously and radically to make a difference in this world. And then they're like, well, why don't you just blow it out, dude? I mean, you could do this and travel and have a blah, 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 and it just goes on and on. And you say, because this is what God is calling me to do. And they're going to mock you. They're going to make fun of you. And if you're not ready to be criticized for your obedience to God, you are not ready to be used by God. You know, I like to teach people and other leaders this. The more you do, the more pain you will experience. If you want to make a difference in this world, you will endure more pain than those who don't. If you want to live a life where nobody criticizes you, let me tell you what to do. Do nothing. Stand for nothing. And have nothing. I choose the bullets. Go ahead and shoot. I would rather do something significant and have people shoot at me than do nothing at all. That's why sometimes, if your church isn't called a cult every now and then, you're not doing jack. You know, I'm dead serious. And they're like, oh, I know that they're a cult. They're just a cult. They're a cult, that stuff that they do over there. And we're like, yeah, you know, bring it on. Okay, fine. Fair enough. Call us that. We can do nothing. There's not nobody that's going to talk about us. Everything significant that I've done in my personal life or I've done together with my church has been met with resistance and criticism. Anything significant is met with spiritual resistance and criticism, personal or professional life. I mean, it's crazy. You know, in personal life, there was a pastor that had 6 kids, and you wouldn't believe the crap they had to go through. They're like, well, 6 kids? What are you, I mean, don't you know what causes that? And they were like, yes, we do, and we're unwilling to give it up. The way they saw it, children were a blessing. They want a couple more blessings than the average family, and that was just them. They felt called to home educate their kids. Now, I homeschooled in the 8th grade. I've never, ever said you should do that. In fact, some of you that listen each week, I know you, you should not do that. It's a personal thing. And people are like, oh, your kids are going to be weird. Yep, because have you seen normal? I mean, they're going to grow up to wear denim skirts and make their own butter. Bring it on, man. Put some butter on that bread. The church that I go to right now is a mega church. And when our pastor started our church, people were like, you don't need another church. Why another church? You know, when our church went church online, there's like people are saying, oh, there's no such thing as church online. And while everybody's arguing about it, our church was just quietly reaching about 150,000 unique computers in countries around the world where you can't get the gospel there any other day. And those numbers have grown every year, up to over 400,000 at a time. Okay, you know, just criticize, you know, shoot away all day long. And then there's multiple sites. There's like, oh, church can't go to multiple sites. It's got to be small to be godly. If you're big, you must be doing something wrong. If the gospel's working and you're reaching people, there's got to be something wrong with that. Churches can just get too big. You know, anything significant you do will be met with criticism and resistance. If you're not ready to be criticized for your obedience to God, you are not ready to be used by God. Because becoming obsessed with what people think about you is the quickest way to forget what God thinks about you. But becoming obsessed with what God thinks about you is the quickest way to forget what people think about you. Thought number one, if you're not ready to get shot at, you're not ready to be used. Well, here's the second thought, and this is probably hopefully going to set some of you free. Extraordinary acts of God often start with ordinary acts of obedience. Let's repeat that. Extraordinary acts of God often start with ordinary acts of obedience. I mean, think about this. The Savior of the world was born when 2 teenage kids said yes to God in a simple act of obedience. What's crazy is, if you try to get to the mind of Mary and Joseph, what did the angel say? You're going to have a boy, going to be named Jesus. He's going to save people. That was it. There's no details like, how are we going to raise him? How are we going to discipline him? Are we going to spank him or put him in time out? I mean, we're dealing with the Son of God here. Okay, so he's perfect. Maybe he'll spank us or put us in time out. There's no details here of how we're going to do this. I mean, it's crazy. And I think there are times when God would say, you know, we're like, show me the details. And God will be like, you can't handle the details. If I showed you everything, you wouldn't take the first step. Now, they didn't know details, and this is what I embrace so often, and that is what we don't have to understand completely to obey immediately. We don't have to see the whole picture to put the first puzzle piece in place and trust God with the rest. Because as we've discussed in other episodes in the past, outcome is whose responsibility? Outcome is God's. What is our responsibility? Obedience is ours. Outcome is God's responsibility. Obedience is ours. Extraordinary acts of God often start with ordinary acts of obedience. And you know, this is so encouraging to me. You have no idea what you might set into motion with one simple obedient act toward God. You have no idea what you might set into motion when you simply obey what God puts on your heart. Now, I'm going to keep teaching this until you understand it. You have no idea what you set into motion when you do what God calls you to do. Craig Rochelle shared this story. In fact, years ago, there was a guy, he said, I can't remember his name, don't even know his name. He just kept coming up to me again and again saying, I don't know why, but God put you on my heart. You've got to go down to this downtown Bible study. He said, I don't know why, but I promise you, you have to go down to this downtown Bible study. Craig was in his 20s or his early 20s at that time. And so finally, Craig went down to the downtown Bible study and he listened to Pastor Nick Harris teach one of the most powerful Bible lessons that he had ever heard. And it was so moving that Craig went to his church on Sunday. And it was so moving that Nick became his pastor. And it was so moving that he ended up inviting him to serve God in full-time ministry at the church and allowed him to go to seminary and helped him to end up starting Life Church. And there's a guy that he doesn't even know his name who helped set something into motion that he had no idea. But a simple act of obedience had a chain reaction of a whole lot that would bring glory to God. He said his wife Amy and I, we had no idea what we would set into motion when we met with 45 people in a two-car garage almost 18 years ago and thought maybe we could do church in a different way. And oh, they criticized. They're like, Oklahoma doesn't need another church. Oklahoma doesn't need another church. The problem is, we didn't realize this. The church wasn't intended just for Oklahoma. God intended something well beyond that. He said we had no idea what would be set into motion with a single act of obedience. He continued, years ago, we were sitting around. We were really frustrated because nobody cares about reading the Bible anymore. And just from their own layperson's assessment, they kind of thought, this is probably the most disengaged generation in the history of Christianity when it comes to reading the Bible. So Craig said they thought, somebody's got to do something about this. It might as well be us. So they took it upon themselves, a small step of faith, and built a little website called YouVersion.com, where it was supposed to be kind of like Facebook, YouTube, and the Bible. They built a community around the Bible. Craig said the problem is it just didn't really work. Nobody would use it except for them, and they only used it because they made it. They really didn't like it. But they had no idea that that was the first step that would lead them through a door that whenever Apple would create apps, they thought, well, I wonder if we turn this into an app. We had no idea, they said, as of today, now that they've given away totally free, no cost to the receiver, over 120 million free YouVersion Bible apps. And that doesn't even count the new and even more popular Kids Bible app. He said, we had no idea that we were set into motion with a single act of obedience. And so this week, when you go and you invite someone to Christmas services, you have no idea how their family might become different. You have no idea how generations might be different by a single act of obedience because God put someone on your heart. When you feel prompted to serve somewhere in your church, you have no idea who you might impact, whose life might be different, how their life might come back to bless you, how much your life will be changed when you do something for somebody else. And suddenly, maybe the high point of your week is when you're an invisible servant serving like Jesus did, and you find love and joy and fulfillment in doing that. Some of you might start to tithe, and one day you look back and you say, I cannot believe what God did in our lives, in our marriage, or in our relationship, in our family, in our finances, when we took this single act of obedience. Some of you might foster or you might adopt, and you don't know the details. You know, there's I don't know and how are we going to, it's going to cost, where are they going to come from? And you don't have to understand completely to obey immediately and take the next step. And years later, you're like, wow, I cannot believe how we changed this life. Or maybe that might surprise you even more. I can't believe how this life ended up changing ours. You may be a single guy and you see a single girl this week, and God's going to prompt you to get up off your single butt and sell your Xbox and get out of your mom's basement, iron a shirt, brush your teeth, and ask her out on a date. And one day you're going to have a son and name him Daniel because God used me to help you get some action in your single life. Glory to God. You have no idea what a single act of obedience can set into motion when you obey what God puts on your heart. Extraordinary acts of God often start with ordinary acts of obedience. And so the angel speaks to Joseph and says, fear not, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because what is in her was conceived by the Holy Spirit. You will give birth to a son, and you will call him Jesus, because he will save people from their sins. Now he's got a choice to make. Does he do what's easy, or does he do what's right? Does he do what people would want him to do, or does he do what God would want him to do? Becoming obsessed with what people think about you is the quickest way to forget what God thinks about you. But becoming obsessed with what God thinks about you is the quickest way to let go of what people think about you. So in this one little verse, we see his decision. And what's so encouraging to me about this one little verse is that God is going to prompt many of you to do something through his word or by his spirit, and one sentence could summarize your response. Here was Joseph's response in verse 24. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. He did what the angel of the Lord commanded him. And through that simple act of obedience, the greatest act of God in human history was brought to fulfillment. You have no idea what you set into motion with a single act of obedience to God. So when God speaks to you and you wrestle with it, what's easy, what's right, what people think, what God thinks, there could be one sentence that is a destiny-altering sentence, and you did what the Lord prompted you to do. I promise you, you have no idea what one single act of obedience can set into motion when you obey what our good God puts on your heart. As you take a moment today, there may be a lot of you who would recognize, like I do, because I so often battle with, not just at the back of my mind, but at the front of my mind, what are they going to think? Am I going to fit in? Do I measure up? Are they going to like me? Where do I stand? If I do this, what are people going to think? And I want with all my heart to overcome this fear of what people think and become so obsessed with what God thinks that I'm not moved by the opinions of people. There are those of you who you would recognize, I'm often more concerned with what people think than I am what God thinks. And today I want to be totally and completely transformed. I want to be different. I want to align myself with the heart of God, and I want to be obsessed with His will, His purpose, His kingdom, His plan, His goodness, and His direction. I want to live for Him, even above the opinions of people. If that's you, on this Christmas week in 2023, I want to say a Christmas time prayer with you. Say, Father, I thank you for the hundreds and hundreds of people this week that genuinely sense the burden and the responsibility, knowing, God, that it's so easy to surrender to the opinions of people. But God, we want to have the courage to obey you no matter what. God, I pray that as we read your word and as we're in your presence, that your Holy Spirit would build our faith, build our passion, God, to obey you. God, understanding that we don't have to understand completely to obey you completely and immediately. And God, I pray that time and time again, even today, when there would be an opportunity to do the wrong thing or do the right thing, when you prompt us, God, that we're always going to do the right thing. God, I pray that we would be sensitive to what your voice would say to lead us, even into doing things that might be uncomfortable, things where people would criticize, that God, we would so much rather please you than have people like us, knowing that people are so fickle anyway. God, I pray that we would be obsessed with you. God, that your kingdom would be first in our hearts. God, that we would obey what you call us to do, and that we could look back at this moment and, God, worship you, thank you, knowing that we had no idea what you had set into motion when we took a simple moment to obey you at your word. God, give us the courage to live above the opinions of people and only God for your approval. Thank you, Lord, and in Jesus' name we pray, amen. From all of us here at Connecting the Gap, we wish you a Merry Christmas. Hope you have an excellent week here coming up. We'll be back next week with another episode of Connecting the Gap. We'll get back into our series, Who is Jesus? Until then, don't forget that God's Word never fails us. God's word has stood the test of time, and through Jesus' death on the cross, he has connected the gap. Merry Christmas from Connecting the Gap. You've been listening to Connecting the Gap podcast. I'm Daniel Moore, the host for this podcast, and I personally thank you for listening each week. In this world, there are many disconnects that cause chaos in our lives. This podcast is birthed from the desire to share hope and restoration of the power of the gospel by being transparent and open in our biblical walk with God. Each week, we take a few moments as we navigate God's Word and peer into other people's testimonies and encourage each other to connect the gap. We upload a new audio podcast every Thursday and a video version of it on YouTube and Rumble. We are also on the Christian podcasting app Edify. You can subscribe to our podcast on many of the available podcasting platforms such as Apple Podcasts, Deezer, Spotify, Google Podcasts, Amazon Music, iHeartRadio, TuneIn Radio, and many more. We are also available on your Alexa-enabled devices. If you would like to give us feedback or would like to contact our ministry for any reason, including prayer, visit our contact page at www.connectingthegap.net and send us a message. We hope you are blessed by this ministry. This is a production of Connecting the Gap Ministries.